again, thank you for just such a powerful film. I want to ask a question and comment right where you left off, but relative to your father. I could feel the pain emanating from him as you were asking questions and taping, particularly the Vietnam piece. And I could feel someone trying to reconcile with that moment in history and also with the fact of what was happening to his family. Could you speak more to that, please?
Sure. Thank you for your question. You know, my father, there was a wonderful, complicated, and painful, beautiful balance in my parents and their relationship. My mother drove a lot of what we experienced both politically, to Angela Davis in her life, Vanya Davis. These
because it's such an anchor and it's so important.
Yes, definitely. I mean, I was playing with this idea of migration, families that are continually looking for it. And so I wanted him to be moving with me in my memory. So he is in the car. And also, as filmmakers, we shoot. We're like,
yeah, sure.
We gotta get him in the car. Shoot the plane. So I can give you like a Google version of it, or I need some footage. My son was there, but I did one part of us taking off was leaving a bit of a question mark. But where are we going? How far am I willing to go in his safety and in helping make a space for him to feel whole? So yes, that's what they're for.
It's all script fault. It's the heart of the fault of being lifestyle, right?
No, this is great because there's also a Grenada moment that's directly connected to climate change, too. Destin Williams, one of the former ambassador to Grenada, who's a dear friend and in the film, and spoke actually in Brooklyn at FAM, the film premiered in New York, you know, talked about what's happening on the island and how the fishing industry is suffering and all these things connected to countries that are on the front line of climate change. So yeah, there's definitely a Grenada moment. And there was another Grenada moment I mentioned to a few of you earlier. In London, when the film premiered, there were 600 plus people in a room, mostly Caribbean descent, that saw themselves in a way that I had just, I mean, all the little nuance, all the things they picked up on. But they were also shouting back at the screen because that was their experience. It was so amazing because you could almost not, you couldn't hear the movie because everyone was like, that's my cousin. And they're like,
final comment for me. I really appreciated, to take off my colleague's question and comment, the mimetic reflection relative to you and your mom and you and your son relative to that transnational transfer and the questioning that's automatically there. And that at the very end of the film, that comes across so very poignantly that those of us who do these translocal, transnational shifts, there it's fraught with those types of questionings of selves and geopolitical spaces and bodies and things of that nature. So I could see the whole notion of your son, your channeling through your son, the types of questioning that you're wondering whether he's going through all of this in the same way in which you did many years back as you were in that transnational space.
Especially right now.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I'm sure everyone's feeling the weight.
That's right.
I also wanted that last frame. John and I worked very hard in picking the final frame of the film. Where my son, you know, we wanted the future to be bright. So it wasn't about us going and being removed or taken somewhere else or escaping or fleeing. connection between telling stories and then importing it into a computer and then spitting it back out. So what we did, we took day one and we took the oldest photos we could find of my grandmother and my great grandmother and went from 1945 to 2018 physically. What taped, the tapes, the journals, the books, and physically looked at our film on the floor, like laid out. And it had colors, it had textures, it had the technology changed so we could see all these things. And that was really our approach. We wanted it to feel like something, which is an incredible luxury. I mean, to spend a year and a half with like one of my best friends looking at all the cool stuff. and it's super great, and we wanted to kind of honor even, my grandfather and grandmother, who deserve cinematographer credits in this film, because they had the vision to pick it up and document what was happening around them. And for an African-American family in the 1950s, to have 8 to 15 hours of Super 8 footage that documents 1950 to 1975 blows my mind.
So as someone, I have two things I want to make sure. So I used to work for Dow Chemical in Clapham, Louisiana. So that's where you guys are. So different day, but some chemicals are good for you. I want to make sure. you talk about the fact that your family still has at least the land or part of the land.
Yes,
that's there. Have you screened this with your? You still sound like a very extended family, but have you screened this with the family? Have you gotten feedback from the family?
Sure.
It's your story, but I'm sure they don't know all the nuances. Or they heard it from maybe just your mother's side.
Right.
You know, there's some dynamics that they may not, when you're at home, you say one thing, but there's something else with us
in
the film.
Right. I would love, it hasn't screened in the town, Geiselman.
Right.
Yeah.
Or Baton Rouge, sure.
They've seen it because it is. Available now, but the LA premiere was very interesting because my grandmother still lives in Los Angeles. My mother was there. My grandmother's 10 friends that are all you know,